do you mind if I tell her? The only person I would like to tell, obviously, is Unai. Can I tell Unai and then I will not tell anybody else and you can tell Sestanin?
Okay, yeah, that's fine.
I'm so sorry, mate, but, you know, you'll get back from this. You know, cruise ships are not a big issue these days.
Of course,
yeah. We will get back from this, no problem.
Cool.
Tomorrow and then go to sleep.
Alright, cool, mate.
Okay, alright.
See you, Garrett. That's alright, man. Thank you. Well. Cruise ship then, innit? No, bro. I really knew anyway, so. I don't like this, bro. I don't like this now.
It's nasty.
Yeah. That looks as well that he's done that on his own. It's not any contact or any player near him.
You know straight away, when a player makes that gesture straight away, you know there's a problem.
Yeah, it's something serious, 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 serious.
My name is Hector Bellerin. I'm a Spanish football player, born in Barcelona, and I play for Arsenal Football Club. I've been there for almost the past decade, I would say. The reason I decided to record this documentary is to take you guys through the actual emotional journey and the things that you know, we go through when we get these kind of injuries. Okay. Thank you, bro. I'm gonna try my best. Thank you, man. Thank you. The day after the injury, I didn't do much but wait for the MRI. Obviously, it was really hard to sleep. I was in pain. And just like thinking about everything, really. What could I have done to not get injured? Did I just like, I don't know. Did I just not prepare for the game properly? Did I just not sleep properly? Did I not eat what I had to eat? All these questions were coming through my head. Gary, the doctor, wanted to make sure. And I remember after the game, he was like, Hector, don't need to worry about it too much at the moment, you know, until we get the results of the MRI. Just don't think anything of it. And I was like, Gary, I know I tore my ACL. It's all good, you know, it's 6 months, 9 months, whatever. Let's just think of it as it is. It was a bit difficult to kind of think and put into perspective the fact that, you know, I've been playing football my whole life. I never had like a big injury like that. So what the hell was I gonna do with my time then? You know, because I've always been interested in things off the pitch and I've been doing them since I was 20, 21, but still I never would have had that much time off the pitch. And that kind of was scary. My injury history prior to that season had been pretty immaculate, I would say. Small issues with my ankles when I was like 16, 17. And apart from a big ankle injury that kind of took me away from the pitch for like 2 months, but didn't require any surgery or anything, the rest were just soft tissue injuries. I think it was the season before I probably played like 48 games in the whole year. So it was pretty good in terms of in terms of how many games I was able to play without injury, etc. Straight away, I knew that it was my ACL. I put my left foot on the ground and I kind of tried to change direction. And as soon as I did that, I just felt a pop in the inside of my knee. This was something very, very different. And, you know, somehow, yeah, I just knew that that's what it was.
When I saw him being stretched out of the pitch, you always think, well, something more serious happens.
Across our sort of high performance medical department, we're sort of scratching our heads, and you always do sort of think maybe it is the worst, either a fracture or an ACL. And unfortunately for Hector, it was a cruciate ligament.
It doesn't look good at all, does it?
No, it doesn't look good at all, and that could be a massive blow for the rest of the season. But listen, fingers crossed, he won't be as bad as he looks.
Kind of got the bad news in the sense that they were suspecting it was something severe. In the meanwhile, I start texting my colleagues here as well, which said that most likely an ACL, there's a mechanism. There's a lot in the clinical picture there with immediate swelling. So a gap when you test, there's some instability on the anterior drawer test, and obviously a lot of pain. Hector describes the mechanism where he felt his knee clicking and going back to place. So from the first day, although the imaging was not performed, it was a straightforward ACL, unfortunately.
You know, there's that little bit of fear in the back of your head that, you know, you're not gonna be able to play football in the same way that you used to play. So that was the only thing that was a bit scary back then. I knew that all the other things, I would have to deal with it after. I remember saying to my friend, like, I'm just worthless, man. The only thing that I know how to do, I cannot do. And at this time, I don't know if I'm gonna be able to do it again. I knew that I was gonna go through a lot of hard times, a lot of obstacles, pain, disappointment, all of these things. You know, the fact that I wasn't gonna live the same life that I was living before.
I've known Hector for almost 18 years now, since we were 8. I'd like to think I'm one of Hector's best mates. We started playing when we were 8 in the Barcelona Academy. That's where our relationships started, when we were like kids, just chasing a ball and playing football. He's a really kind-hearted guy. Like, he's got a huge heart. I meet people with the heart of Hector and know that you'll have them in your life probably till we die, so it goes beyond football, I'd say. I remember my agent messaging me and saying to me, it looks like Hector's done his knee. So I put the game straight on, and it was just, I was a bit in shock and a bit sad, because just by seeing the replay, you could tell it wasn't a nice one. You could see the way his knee like went into that position and then he bounced off it. It's never a good image when you see that of any footballer, but with someone you know so well and you know so closely, it just hurts that little bit more. He was obviously disappointed, but at the same time you could see like he was hungry for the challenge almost, like saying, look, you can't change the injury, you can't change what's happened, all you can do is just focus on the way up, on the way back.
The outlook I had on the injury at the beginning was, I think, very realistic and very positive. I decided to vlog. At that time, I didn't know what was gonna come off this vlog. One of my friends, as soon as I got injured, and he knew it was gonna be a long time, got me a notebook and a pen, and he was like, Hector, you gotta write down your thoughts, you know, you gotta write something about everything that's gonna happen to you, and maybe in the future you will cherish it, or maybe you'll share it with people. A lot of things go through your head, right? in these times, and sometimes talking to someone. And for me, talking to the camera, talking to all the people behind the screens, that was an exercise for me to be able to open up and to be able to tell people what I was feeling, and sometimes feeling vulnerable of what I was gonna say, knowing that after that was gonna go on YouTube and people were gonna see it. You know, I knew that possibly that experience would have had the chance to help people that was going through the same stuff.
It's around 11 o'clock now. I just been stretched off from the game against Chelsea. Hello everyone. It's day two. Still, there's not many things we can say about it. Yeah, at the moment, today it feels like more swollen than yesterday, more painful. I'm trying not to have some too many painkillers, because I don't really like them personally. Third day, I've received the news from Gary, the doctor, that I've got an external cruciate ligament injury. And it's day four now. What day is it?
I never saw Hector in a negative or two down. I think he's always had that support to keep him positive. I saw him and he was quite upbeat, joking about his knee, the size of his quads, and joking about my past injuries like we do. So that sense of humour, to put a smile on a bad situation and to stay positive and happy, and yeah, that's who Hector is.
Tech is mad already, it's been 3 days. Mad. Oh.
I went to Barcelona for two reasons. One of them being my family were there. I knew I needed the support, I knew they would take care of me. Second one is because Dr. Cugat was in Barcelona. Loads of football players have done surgeries with him. I just thought it was the best decision to do the first few weeks of rehab plus the surgery over there.
This bug. Maza! Absolute Maza! 1995.
Leaving London, it just felt kind of weird that football was still going on. My teammates were still playing, they were still training, and I was gonna be, in Barcelona. There's many things I like about London. I've shaped my life around this city, and this city has shaped me. If my family would have been living here in the UK, I probably would have, you know, decided to do my surgery over here or something and do the rehab here. But at that time, for me, family was more important than, you know, that where I was. I just wanted to be close to them. My mental health was probably as important as the surgery, and Gary, the doc, was very supportive in terms of like, Hector, if you need to go to Spain, go to Spain.
Players are from all different types of the world, and as much positive they are in these moments, there's one common thing to all of them. If they can choose to be close to family in a familiar environment, in their hometown, so the better. there was an immediate tendency to choose Barcelona as a place to get the surgery.
Okay, so we're on the plane, we're about to take off to Barcelona. The whole time at the airport, I've been in a wheelchair. I had such a hard time because I'm also not used to people doing stuff for me or like, you know, like I can do nothing.
Well, very good afternoon to you, ladies and gentlemen. So much for the captain of the South Coast, I'll find out.
Flight was good, man. Turbulence was mad, but spilled all the coffee on my tracksuit. But glad I could make it. Glad we could make it. And it's like 7 o'clock here now. I've got a meeting with the doctor at 8 o'clock. So yeah, we're just gonna check in the bags and stuff, and then see Mr. Kubat.
I am an orthopedic surgeon. I was involved in the Football Federation from 23 September 1965. That is the reason I know a lot of soccer players, coach, trainers, a lot of people in this world, not only here in Spain, around the world. Hector needs to have confidence with you, and you need to speak, explain. Okay, you have rupture anterior cruciate ligament, but doesn't matter. Nowadays, it's possible to do surgery, and the most common is go back to play. Don't worry.
It always reassures a football player when they go to some doctor that has a large experience working with athletes, especially if they are from the same sport. Once you go to an appointment that you already believe in the person that's behind the desk, I think things become so much easier. It's a matter of belief, and I think that's why sometimes the clubs, especially at this level, they do facilitate for the player to lean towards a particular surgeon.
I mean, I was comfortable with Cugat. I know he had massive experience from many, many years ago. He had surgeries to some of my teammates and friends, so I knew I was in the best hands possible. So, there was no doubt in my head that the surgery was going to be successful.
And I explained that's the anterior cruciate ligament. It's a rupture because this ligament is so easy to rupture. When any distortion, sometimes the shoes is fixed. And the most common is when you rotate. And what happened in the rotation? And then valgus and flexion, and finally translation. That is the most common mechanism of injury of the anterior cruciate ligament. And sometimes in 6 months, 7 months, it's possible to go back. But I explain, if it's possible to wait minimum 7, 8, or 9, it's much better.
We already had the results of the MRI scan, so we knew it was an ACL. And one of the things, I thought I was gonna get surgery probably the day after or something like that, but he said that I had to do rehab before the surgery. So the swelling on my knee would go, and he said that could take time off the actual rehab.
Lateral ligament on the scan. looks okay, but it does open up.
Yeah.
Open up like this. But the meniscus, I think, is quite a complex tear.
My injury was on the 18th of Jan, and I didn't get my surgery until 12 days later, on the 30th. So towards the end of those 2 weeks, my knee was feeling much better. So I was like, maybe I don't need to have surgery, but obviously I did need to. And it was that was his first diagnosis.
Maybe before then, week will be difficult. Maybe.
We checked the knee and then said, okay, yes, anterior cruciate ligament, and said, okay, demonstrate the rupture of anterior cruciate ligament plus a little injury of the lateral meniscus, but said, please take care. Now, the most important is to avoid inflammation, stop the inflammation, to get range of motion of the knee and no pain. And then the knee is ready to go to the surgery room.
As soon as I knew we had that injury, I've never had a ligament injury, but I've had problems with the knee, so I could relate to that a little bit. So all I said to them was like, just relax, everything. You're in the best hands in the world, probably, with the surgeon in Spain, with Ramon Cugat. So that's something he didn't need to worry about, the surgery, because it was going to go well.
Instead of like 15 days, it ended up being 12. It was just waiting, you know, it was, I just couldn't wait for the surgery to be over to then actually start the proper rehab. So it got a bit annoying at some point, and I was just, you know, speaking to the physios and saying like, come on, man, like, it looks good. Like, I should go ahead and do it. And they were like, no, honestly, wait. You're gonna be thankful once you go into your actual rehab. I miss the dressing room, I miss my teammates, I miss waking up in the morning, doing what I loved, I miss seeing everyone at the training ground. You know, people think rehab or, you know, our careers are just a straight line up, and it's really not like that. It's so many ups and downs, just from like day to day, from the morning till the evening, constantly ever-changing emotions, physical sensations, feelings. It was very difficult at times, and I think it was normal for me to doubt.
You just follow the process, which for the first period is checking the severity, and then you take decisions from there. But you know that the goals will fit on the time frame based on what type of surgery he's going to have.
At the time, his family was in Barcelona. When you have a setback like that, from my experience as well, all you want to do is be around the people you trust the most and be around the people you love the most, and that's family.
It was all about setting small goals and be like, okay, now I'm going to do the surgery. After the surgery, I'm going to wait for them to take my stitches out of my knee. Setting these little short-term goals that, you know, slowly would take me to the bigger goal, which was being back on the football pitch.